We welcome Dr. R. Sarita, Principal Scientist, ANGR Agriculture University, Regional Agriculture Research Station, Anakapalli, Visakhapatnam, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
A warm greetings to all the participants and delegates. Dear friends, I am Dr. Sarita, working as Principal Scientist in Acharya N.G. Ranga Agricultural University. Presently working at Regional Agricultural Research Station, Anakapalli. However, I have been working in the university since 18 years and I have worked extensively in the field of teaching, extension as well as research. So friends, today I want to share my views on gender issues in agriculture. Dear friends, actually, sex is often confused with gender. Let me make it clear that gender is social whereas sex is biological. Gender refers to the qualities or characteristics that the society ascribes to each sex. To put it in simple words, a person is born male or female but learns his role in the society as a man or woman as directed by the society and the cultural norms. In all cultures, gender determines roles and responsibilities as well as the power and resources of women and men. Here comes two words, gender equality and gender equity. We need to understand the difference between these two words. Gender equality refers to a position where women and men enjoy equal rights and opportunities, whereas gender equity refers to fairness and impartiality in the treatment of women and men. So, dear friends, we need equity to achieve equality in the long run. Friends, I want to share a few facts with you regarding the role of women in agriculture. Women make up 43% of the formal agricultural workforce globally, whereas women produce on average, more than half of all the food that is produced in the world. It is up to 80% in Africa and up to 60% in Asia. Women also participate in all sorts of farm activities. Joint participation of women in crop production activity is around 75% for all the major food crops that we eat, 79% for horticultural produce, and women also play a major role in post-harvest operations by 51% of joint participation. It is ironical to note that despite being a great contributor to the field of agricultural production, less than 10% of the women farmers cultivate in their own land. Only 15% of the world's agricultural extension agents are the Department of Agricultural persons are women. Less than 10% of the credits and loans from the banks or finance agencies are directed towards women. Pathetically, wages to women are also 30 to 50% lower than that of men for the same type of physical drudgery. Now, coming to the gender issues faced in agriculture. First is the lack of extension service. The venue, timing, and duration of the training program or demonstration are not appropriate for the women. They are conducted during the peak busy hours for women, and also the content and methodology are not gender sensitive. Secondly, land ownership. Women's lack of ownership of land or access to land continues to be the major obstacle to increasing their contributions or benefits for agricultural production. Then comes overburden of work. Women work hectically for 15 to 16 hours of day during the entire crop growth period. Next is the gender bias in development policies. Policymakers mostly treat the women as consumers rather than producers and plan the policies accordingly. Then comes limited access to market although we all know that women worldwide are very active as vendors and hawkers, little has been done to assist them with improved transport and marketing facilities. Then, the lack of education. Due to illiteracy, women are forced to work as unskilled laborers many a times. My dear friends, studies show that closing the gender gap can increase the agricultural productivity worldwide by over 10%. To bridge the gender gap and empower women with new knowledge and technology is a great challenge to food security and agricultural productivity, particularly in the present context of socio-economic and climate-related changes. So, FAO has also said that gender equality and food security should be the slogan as women's empowerment as a tool against hunger. Now, let us briefly discuss the strategies to address gender equity. The first is provision of equal wages. As we have already said that the wages are 30 to 50% lesser than men. So, laws to make the wages equal among men and women would address the issue of gender equity. Then enrolling more female extension workers so that they are more sensitive towards the problems faced by women farmers and guide them accordingly. Formation of women's self-help groups and microcredit groups have been very successful wherever they are adopted, and this has to be widely adopted. Next is modify and simplify the access to credit and inputs by the financing agencies, because most of the women are illiterate and have very less time to run around the financing agencies or banks. Then the formation of cooperatives for marketing. Formation of cooperatives for marketing provides women with a platform to get good price for their produce. Then comes gender-oriented capacity building. Capacity building programs like brainstorming, method demonstrations, field visits, exposure visits, training programs, all these should be gender-oriented. Then focus on drudgery reduction tools, especially coming to exercises like transplanting, weeding, or intercultural operations. Women have or even harvesting, women need better tools to reduce the load of drudgery upon them. Then, conducting of large-scale trainings and workshops to make women more active in decision-making. Finally, the access to education. This is most important to achieve gender equity, especially in agriculture. A cost-benefit analysis carried out by the World Bank indicated that if women received the same amount of education as men, farm yields would rise by between 7 to 22%, while increasing the primary schooling alone could increase agricultural output by 24%. So this is the importance of education for women, especially for the upliftment of agricultural productivity. So in conclusion, I would like to say that women have to be treated as farmers. Their contribution to agriculture has to be given due recognition and respect. If we are for development, we have to be for women. Thank you all for giving me this opportunity.
We request Dr. Madhuri Irene, Associate Professor, IFKCAI Law School, Hyderabad, Telangana, India, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
Good morning, everyone. It's Dr. Madhuri, and I'm really privileged to have my paper presentation in this International Conference of Women Leadership. I'm going to make the presentation on my titled, the article titled Praising Women and Piercing Feminism, A Belief Beguiled. So right from the beginning, when you talk about the women leadership, my ideology is women even having lot of potentiality, but she's all the time praised and her feminism has been pierced and her belief has been bewildered. So this is ideology. So I start up my article with Ethiopian proverb, where a woman rules, the streams run uphill. So by this, I start my presentation saying that woman by nature, she is a creator and a protector of the family, leading the group of diverse thoughts, ages, and attitudes is a natural character of a woman. She makes the leaders and she compromises to be led for the benefit of all, be it to be a family or institution or a business. Right from the beginning, woman is all the time dedicated herself to be a protector and the caretaker of not only a family but also to the society. So when you talk about the concept of the woman leadership, my article has been divided into 5 parts where I have discussed about woman as a leader, whether she has been dreaded or she has been discarded. And number 2, the area of the feministic, I can say the equality, that is the discrimination made in upbringing or taking the woman into consideration, especially in the area of the leadership. And 3rd is, what is the entrepreneur pedagogy with regarding to the feministic concept, and what are the small steps and how it has been entered as a big leap in women's life, and what is the area where you can stop and you can proceed. Now coming to the woman as a leader, when you look into the woman as a leader, woman entrepreneurship is neither an oxymoron or a tautological trance, but it is a scintillating testimony of a feministic power and potential. Entrepreneurship is a natural attitude or a characteristic charisma of a woman in all the ages of human existence, creation, nurturing, guiding, and disciplining the nature of human conduct and the business. Woman is assured in a new area in space and technology, administration, governance, management of the global life. So woman is in every phase of the life where you could see her achievements. For example, when you look into Geeta Gopinath, US citizen of Indian origin, is the one of the most outstanding economists of the world, and because of her impeccable academic credentials, she had been nominated as a CEO of International Monetary Fund. When you look into Donna Strickland, became the 3rd woman scientist next to Marie Curie in the year 1903. And when you look into Lalita Ambika, the director of Human Space Program at ISRO, a role model of female scientist. Mrs. Frances H. Arnott, the winner of half of 2018 Chemistry Nobel Prize. And she is the 5th woman scientist in chemistry. And our exceptional celebrities like Shakuntala Devi, Durgabai Deshmukh, Indira Gandhi, etc. There are number of names where we can take it. They are the successful leaders of the, the women entrepreneurs. But even though the women entrepreneurs are there throughout the globe where number is given, the problem here is the feministic prudence and the victory has been encountered and crossed the scores of hurdles of time, situations and humans and its historic evolution. A series of mysteries and monuments and marvels where we could see entrepreneurship of a woman is moving from individual to the social entrepreneurship. So when you look into the global economic reports, where I want to talk about WEF, that is World Economic Forum gender gap. When you look into the gender gap, India is placed in 108, where Bangladesh, where we call it as a poor country, is in 57th rank. And we are after very poor countries also, India, when you talk about the comparison of the gender gap, it has stand and 108. Likewise, as per the same WEF report 2020, India has been stood at 112 out of 153 countries. And UNDP HD report observed that women make the greater and faster progress where their individual empowerment and social power is low, that is basic capacities. But if they face the glass ceiling where there have been a greater responsibility and the political leadership. So when you look into this kind of gap, it has been shown that the women development is a stage where this development has been entered into, not a simple development of entrepreneurship, but it is in total the development of a woman, that is gender and the development and women rights and human rights. Of course, women, the development of women has been taken place in several areas, and I can quote even 1990s witness the revolutionary rise of rights, and there is a support of NGOs and women entrepreneurs. Slowly the rights have been given to the women in the sexual, reproductive, violence free life. So many areas it has been come, but when it comes to the entrepreneurship of the women, according to the Fortune 500 list, only 61 women CEOs have entered into that particular Fortune list. So it could see that like only we have 5 women out of 58 leaders. So when you look into the concept of the women's rights or the women's history, how the differentiation of the women has been made. So another notable aspect which I can take, the success of the women celebrities are predominantly appeared in the corporate sectors. There are several women CEOs and there, but the thing is the talented woman has been stepped ahead with regarding to the small scale industries or medium enterprises, MSMEs, where we could see lot of, the development has been taken, woman entrepreneurship has been got, no matter whether it is a Richard Popper, no matter whether it is an Amul ice cream. So ultimately woman has started taking a step after step. But one thing please do remember that the women leadership has totally, I don't say that it is totally snubbed or kept in a cold storage, but the women has been, there is no proper progress of women empowerment, and this can be possible only when there is an international, the development of women is not properly made, whether it is a international, national agencies, only through the help of the agencies with help, self-help groups and NGOs, there was a development of women. So when you take the example is the group of active women entrepreneurs in Middle East and North Africa, MEN, MENA, and Lebanon identity challenges, where we could see the women participation in various areas has been taken into consideration. But all said and done, whatever we said, one thing please be remember, the freedom and shape and destiny of a woman is only when there is an atmosphere without a discrimination by her own counterpart, that is male, and just and moral aptitude and right attitude of humanity is necessary. Remember that the only partnership of enlightened men and a brave woman is a wonderful combination to create a meaningful, fruitful, better world in future. And these men should treat the women not as their invulnerable competitors, but as their dependable aliens. Now remember, woman is a daring damsel in the business and caring cherishma at home. So too much entrepreneurship means disruption, running the wild. Too little entrepreneurship means economy tailing out. So when you look into the concept here, I just want to end up my presentation by quoting, "Woman knows how to balance the interest of the family and the profession." As Dennis Karlick says, "Women are leaders wherever you look, from a CEO to a housewife that holds together a home and to be a successful leader." And the same way, Mary Kay, as founder of Mary Kay Cosmetics, she has said, "When you reach an obstacle, turn it into an opportunity. You have the choice, you can overcome and be a winner, or you can allow it to overcome you and to be a loser. And the choice is yours and yours alone. Refuse to throw into the towel. Go that extra mile, that failures refuse to travel. It is far better to be exhausted from success than be rested from the failure. So thank you so much for giving me this opportunity for my presentation, and your questions and your suggestions are always welcome. Thank you, and I thank the authorities, the organizers of this conference, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you so much.
We now request Dr. Chaitali Chaudhary, Associate Professor, Bijoy Krishna Girls College, Howrah, West Bengal, India, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
Audience present, wishing you all a very good day. Today, the topic of my presentation is Women's Rights and Gender Inequality. I am Dr. Chaitali Chaudhary, Associate Professor in Philosophy in Bijoy Krishna Girls College, Howrah. The country which had no respect for womanhood could never become great. Such was the observation of Swami Vivekananda, the great social, religious, revolutionary saint. Society where women are treated with importance and due respect is bound to gain inherent strength in respect of culture, ethics, and morality. The cherished goal of humanity all over the world is to achieve gender equality and ensure empowerment of women. Even though our country has made great progress and remarkable achievements in many fields, still there remains too wide a gap between the rich and the poor and the opportunities available to men and women. Men and women form the two pillars on which the society revolves and evolves in its way towards development. Both men and women require to have an open mind and suitable education to make it a reality. Empowerment of women, that is to say, providing equal rights, equal opportunities, and equal responsibility for women, is to be regarded as an utmost necessity to end the existing gender discrimination in society. As per the country report of Government of India, empowerment means moving from a position of enforced powerlessness to one of power. In view of the present pandemic situation, women have been violated in many ways. The social, economic, cultural, and moral conditions of humanity in the lockdown phases have deteriorated to such an extent that the natural bonding between the people have worsened. And who else but the women have suffered the brunt of the situation. Today we see domestic violence has accelerated and the rate of divorce is also going up. Here our topic of discussion is, are women's rights actually possible and how far can they be made pragmatically useful? The objective of the discussion is twofold. Firstly, are the rights conferred on women practically viable or are they simply theoretical? How far are they practically utilized to abolish gender discrimination in society? Women have access to all rights equally as their male counterparts. In fact, if the rights conferred to both men and women were actually embraced with their proper meaning and connotation, there would have been no discrimination in the society. However, it is noted very unfortunately that women are deprived of the very basic of the fundamental rights, is the right to life or the right to live. The notions associated with that of women's rights are right to autonomy, right to vote, right to protest legally against any kind of violence, right to speak freely and to have equal rights in family matters, right to work and equal wages with their male counterparts, right to procreate, right to own a property, right to health, and the right to education. The National Organization for Women was created in 1966 to bring about equality for all women. Right to education here plays an important role, as it is through education women are made aware of the significance of literacy, legality, and the capacity and the right to protest. It is about equipping the women with power and allowing them to make life-determining decisions among the various problems in society. Now we come to the methodology section. Here the methodology for the discussion can be done in two ways. Theoretically, we have to amass the kind of rights women actually enjoy and what they are deprived of. From the practical point of view, investigation is to be done as to why women are deprived of certain rights and whether gender discrimination actually starts from there. In order to come out of this situation, that is to say, after the gender discriminating situation, women have to fight such inequalities with the instrument of education, which would uplift their position in the society and improve their status within the family as well. That is to say, the practical utilization of women's rights brings about the emancipation and empowerment of women. Finally, we come to the conclusion. The rights conferred on people in a society, respective of men and women, are the same. But it is felt very normally in all practical purposes that gender inequality and discrimination has been the norm of the society. Women have access to all rights equally as their male counterparts. Therefore, recognition of women's rights cultivates positive self-image and self-confidence and thereby helps to sail over gender discrimination very sensibly. Finally, we can say that rights are not only accessory to decorate a woman, but are pragmatically to be used in any situation as per the requirement. Rights are to be made practically useful to make anyone, be it men or women, self-confident, aware, self-conscious, and make oneself utilized in the society. Thank you.
We now request Dr. Chintala Venkata Sivasai, Assistant Professor, School of Buddhist Studies and Civilization, Gautam Buddha University, Greater Noida, Uttar Pradesh, to kindly present his paper. Sir, please.
Good morning, all of you. Of the women, because women is going to be making the all factors which are related to women believe that women has no salvation could be gained. It means that in contrast between such a hindrance as exotic religious practices, Buddhism can certainly claim how to the least discrimination attitude against the women. So in this case, women is discriminated is a common, but in the case of Buddhism, Buddha gives the open gate for the participation of women in all Buddhist spiritual religious practices. That's why in the history of religion, the woman is giving freedom by the Buddhism, only one religion other than the other religion. So there are many claims, many testimonies that there is nuns in the days of Buddha speak simply of the fact related. Buddha had opened the gates for the full practice of women in the field of religion by making them eligible for admission in what they know, Bhikkhuni Sangha, in address of nuns, the social service and ample opportunities in particular. So what was the social attitude towards women at the time of Buddha? The social attitude toward women in pre-Buddhism days can be traced from the early Vedic literature, such as the Rig Veda. There is an evidence indicating that honor, respect women is received in their homes, but in the outside, the woman is completely prohibited. So, however, such a liberal attitude toward women changed the course of time under the influence of dominance, was a priestly caste along with the priestcrafts and animal sacrifices. So that in case women were looked down upon some mere possession or thing, her place was the home under the complete whims and fancies of her husband. So woman is completely, she not only had to perform all domestic chores, but also bring a large family. So some of the priest caste Brahmins married and lived their wives regarded the food cooked women pure unfit to eat. So if a married woman had no children or failed to produce a male offspring, she might upon suspend second or third wife even turned into that. So in that case, woman is continuously having some discriminated in all society from the Vedic and the come to the present now. So in the field of religious practice, women, the position which they can enjoy was denied of them. So women as believed to be unable to go heaven through their own marriage, she could not be worshipped herself, and it was believed that she could not reach the heaven uniqueness of that. According to Buddha, the law of karma, one is responsible for one's own action and its consequence. The well-being of the father or grandfather does not depend upon the action of the son or grandson. They were responsible for their own action. Such enlightened teachings helped correct the views of many people, naturally reduce the anxiety of women which were unable to produce such forms of traits and ancestries. So in the early period, the woman, unmarried girl, would go to Elan and abuse, contend, and abuse adequately caring for parents, younger brothers and sister. She might even the owner of great possession of slaves and such a fields as did Subha, the daughter of goldsmith during the time of Buddha. So Dhamma taught her Mahapati, the Mahaprajapati, Subha realized the nature of all. So in this example, the teachings of Buddha has done great deal to wipe off many superstitutions, beliefs and meaningless rites and rituals, including animal sacrifice, from the minds of many people. So the true nature of life and death, the nature of phenomena governing universe was there. So here, the method of women as a nature, methods, despite that Buddha had elevated status of women, he has practically observation advice given from time to time. He realized social and physiological difference that existed between men and women. So in the Anguttara Nikaya, the Buddhist text clearly mentioned that the human duty, the man's duty in his unending quest for knowledge, improvement and stabilization of skills, craftsman education. But in the case of another hand, the Anguttara Nikaya contained some valuable advice to Buddha had given to the youngest girls prior to their marriage, realized that there was bound some difficulties with new in-laws. So the girls re-enjoined give every respect to the mothers-in-law, fathers-in-law, serving them lightly, lovingly to their own patterns. So this case, Buddha attitude to men also been some new of the birth of the birth daughter was brought into fame, King Kosala, King displeased the news as the expected son. Buddha, unlike any other religious teacher, paying tribute to women and meritorious certain characteristic Kannada women in the following words. This example, the woman, Buddha gave an advice for the married woman. He gave some advices. The first advice is, should not harbor evil thoughts against her husband. The second one is, should not be cruel, harsh or domineering. Third one, should not be spendthrift, but should be economical, live with her means. The D, fourth one, should jealously guard, save her husband, property, and hard earning earnings. Next, should always be virtuous and chaste in mind and action. Should be faithful and harbor no thought of any adulterous acts. Should be refined speech and polite in action. Next, should be kind, industrious, and hardworking. Next point, should be thoughtful and compassionate towards her husband, and attitude towards should be good, equal mother, loving and protecting her only son. Should be modest and respectable. Should be cool, calm, understanding, serving not only as a wife, but also a friend, advisor to her husband when need arises. These are all the advices Buddha given to the married woman. Next, I come to that, towards equality and freedom. In the modern era, 19th and 20th century, the far cry from the days of Buddha, women emancipation and quest for freedom and equality had achieved tremendous strides, particularly in the West. So this is the was the result of modern trends and modern education for women in all spheres of higher learning. So this woman is the complete given the freedom, in the Buddha time, even now also Buddhist countries gives a lot of freedom for the women to participate all spiritual meeting, religious meeting, other than the household activities. So they believe that women had a role play in the patriotic fellowship, which they took building a better society and country. Since even 1848, the world witnessed an innumerable popular organized movement for the educational, equal educational opportunities, equal political rights and economic equality for women. In the West, the status of women was enhanced by conditions generated by industrial revolution, humanitarian movements and women movement for equality. In Asia and other countries which were not so industrially advanced, the change was brought about reforms with a strong and applicable background. So during the last 60 to 70 years, the study process of increasing women participation in the economic, social, as well as political life of their countries had been pouring head in steadily. So the success of achieved by women in the 20th century can only be described phenomenal. Women had achieved success in the various fields of endeavor, social science, business, economics, political field. In some countries, women have even succeeded capturing the most political appointments, like prime minister of their land, and ironically, NF in certain countries. So women had to be given franchise right to vote. International action raised the status of women as being small way of with the different League of Nations. The first war, subsequently, United Nations Charter, the further go grant to the principles of equality and freedom to all women. At the organ of action, the Commission Status of Women probed the question of discrimination based on sex and deliberated question touching the political rights of women, equal place for equal work. The status of women in common law, the nationally married women, educational and economic opportunities for women, technical assistance and participation by women. So conclusion I would like to make in this paper, can women become leaders in easily the Buddhism? Because Lord Buddha given open the gates for all women to participate in all political, social, religious, spiritual in action for all the religious women. So in the history of world, the status of women has been enormously increased given by the Buddha 2560 years ago. So even Buddhist countries are also given lot of priority for women. So women leadership became women leader easily acceptable in all Buddhist societies and Buddhist country. So the promoting cause of women, Buddha can be considered as the first emancipator of women and promoter of women, the promoter of democratic way of life. So it is to be eternal credit to Buddha Dhamma that women not deposit, look down, but even equal status with men in their spiritual endeavor and the way of gain wisdom and complete deliverance. This is called Nibbana. So this is my brief juncture of my paper, Can We Become Leaders in Buddhist Tradition. So I would like to give thanks to the opportunities for presenting my paper in the international webinar on Roman Leadership by the Red Topic. Thank you, Anand Alman, thank you.
We now request Dr. Bhavna Sharma, Faculty School of Law, Christ Deemed to be University, Delhi, NCR, India, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
Hello, everyone. Myself, Dr. Bhavna Sharma. I'm working as a faculty in School of Law, Christ Deemed to be University, Delhi, NCR. I'm going to discuss my research paper on prostitution in India, a critical analysis. In this particular research paper, I will focus on the issues which is resulting into the prostitution in our country, different laws which are governing the prostitutions in India, forced prostitution. I will make a little bit explanation on the whether this prostitution has been legalized or not, what are the side effects of that. Still, we are not having any legalization, any particular law which is talking about the prostitution in our country. Then I will discuss about the constitutional and human right of the prostitutes. I will make the focus on the what the judicial interpretations is there, which is talking about the prostitution rights in our country. Then I will conclude my paper with certain suggestion on that. So, the prostitute, the word itself narrate and reflect on the situation of a woman. The word prostitution has derived from the Latin word prostitua, means to exploit publicly. Prostitution denotes rendering sex service in lieu of money or for other favors. Here, I want to emphasize that we should not miss an important aspect of the prostitution, that prostitution is not all about the female sex worker only. It includes the male counterpart, although it is less in number and not in miserable condition as in the comparison of the first one. But as the Article 14 of the Indian Constitution says that the state shall not deny to any person equality before law and the equal protection of the law. So, while making the law for the prostitution, for the female sex worker, we cannot eliminate the aspect of the male sex workers. Globally, if we are talking about the legalization of the prostitution, prostitution has been legalized in Canada, France, Denmark, Holland, Israel, Australia, and many other countries. But in India, legalization of prostitution is still pending. If we are talking in aspect of the Indian context, prostitution is not illegal but pronounced unethical by the court. In the year of the 1956, Parliament enacted a law which is talking about the Immoral Traffic Prevention Act for governing the prostitution in India. This act claim at suppressing prostitution in women and girls and achieving a public purpose, that is, to rescue to fallen women and girls and to provide the opportunity so that they could become decent members of society. The constitutional validity of this act was challenged in the state of the Uttar Pradesh versus Kaushalya. Allahabad High Court declared this particular act as a constitutional in this particular scenario. This act has been replaced by the Immoral Traffic Prevention Act 1986. According to this act of the year of the 1986, if the prostitute is working as per their own consent and has no problem, then it should not be considered as illegal. So with this particular two acts, it is clear that in our country, prostitution has not been declared as illegal if it is doing by the woman or the girl or other person by willingly. But if it is the forced prostitution, we are having certain punishment against the person who are forcefully putting up women in this particular profession. Now I'm giving a certain rights for the prostitute itself. which is given in the Constitution of India and given in there as a human right also. So if we are talking about the Constitution of India, first of all, we are having the preamble of the Constitution with us. Preamble of the Constitution is the key, means whatever the provision has been given in the entire Constitution itself, we can see the preamble and can design what our Constitution maker want to achieve with this Constitution. So if we are looking for the preamble of the Constitution preamble guarantees social and economic justice to all citizens. What is the meaning of social and economic justice? So economic justice, whenever we are talking about right to work. So if due to the poverty, any woman is going towards the prostitution profession, so our Constitution giving them empowerment to do the act, whatever they are doing, whatever they are doing willingly, not forcefully. And one more guarantee we are having under the preamble, that is social justice. So social justice means equal treatment with all the member of the society, whether what profession they are doing, what profession they are not doing, the equality will not depend on that. Secondly, we are having, preamble is talking about the equality of the status and equality of the opportunity and dignity of the individual. So these are the certain guarantees which we can imply, which we can enforce on the right of the prostitutes as well. So if there is any woman who is willingly doing due to the poverty reason or due to any other reason, this particular prostitute job, so they must have certain right with themselves. If they are the citizen of India, if they are living in the, residing in the country, which is democratic country, which is giving the so much fundamental right to the citizen of India, so there must be certain fundamental right of the prostitutes as well. Now I'm coming on that part, what fundamental rights prostitutes have. All the fundamental rights are available to the citizen of India, whatever is given from the Article 12 to Article 35. Now I will emphasize here three fundamental rights, which is can be, if we are giving the these particular fundamental right to the prostitutes as well. So they are having the right to live a life in a dignified manner. No one can violate this particular right, whatever they are having under the Constitution. So first of all, I want to emphasize Article 14. So Article 14 says, state shall not deny equality before law or equal protection of law. So whatever the right we are having under Indian Constitution or other act, the prostitutes have the same right under the Constitution or under the other acts. Secondly, we are having a most important fundamental right with us, that is Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. Article 21 of Indian Constitution talk about the right to life and personal liberty. Means no person shall be deprived from the life and the personal liberty except the procedure established by law. Means the state cannot deprive any person from the right to life and personal liberty if there is no law which is prescribed by the legislature. Here I want to emphasize again, if we are talking about the right to life and personal liberty, it is not the life, just an animal existence. It is something more than that. As in Mehka Gandhi case or different case law, Supreme Court has interpreted that here in Article 21, we are talking about the right to live a life in a dignified manner. And if we are talking about the right of this particular, this right of the citizen, so this right is available to the prostitutes as well. Means they are also having the right to dignity and they are also having the right to live a life in a dignified manner, not as animal existence. So if they are having that particular right, why they are not having any particular law which is talking about the upliftment of the prostitutes in our society? We should make certain type of law for the upliftment of the this unprivileged member of the society. So of course, whenever we are talking about the prostitutes' right, we are having the focus on the right of the prostitutes as well as right of the children of the prostitutes as well. They are the, also the citizen of India. They are also the member of our society. Why the society is not looking for that? Every woman is not going in this particular profession with their choice. So So they are not doing this willingly. But if they are involved in this particular profession, we should have certain laws for the upliftment of this weaker section of the society. Again, one fundamental right, they are having Article 23. Article 23 is talking about the prohibition of human trafficking and forced labor. So if any human being, if any woman or any maid of the society is forcefully they are doing this particular profession, that is prostitution profession. So they are having the fundamental right again under Article 23. Then we are having the certain directive principle of the state policy, which is giving the direction to the state for making certain rule and regulation for the benefit of the person. Whenever we are talking about the directive principle of the state policy, all the principle, whatever we are having under Article 36 to 51, this is for the providing the social and economical welfare to the members of the society. So here I will emphasize two articles only. Article 39F. Under Article 39F, the state has given the direction to make the laws. This type of laws they can frame for the upliftment of the, for providing the children an opportunity and facilities to develop in a healthy manner. So Article 39F states that children should be given opportunity and facilities to develop in a healthy manner, and dignity and freedom of child should not be compromised. So if the state is making the laws for the betterment of the children means whenever we are talking about the children, there must be certain laws. We are very much aware about that. And Article 13, Article 15, Clause 3 says about that if the state is framing any law with a special reference to the women and children, it should not be considered as a violation of the Constitution or the violation of the fundamental right, whatever we are having under Article 15, means discrimination on the basis of the sex, caste, etc. But if the state is making any law for the betterment of the unprivileged member of the society under which women and children has been covered under Article 15, Clause 3, it should not be considered as a violation of the Article 15. So again, under Article 39F, the state has given certain direction for making the laws, which is talking about the welfare of the children. But what about the children of the prostitutes? Are they not come in this particular category? Of course, they should come. So the state can frame any special laws for the upliftment of the children of the prostitutes as well, regarding their education, regarding their juvenile home, regarding their certain rehabilitation center. They can frame the special laws for them as well. Then Article 46 we have with us, which directs the state to promote the educational and economic interest of the women and people of the weaker section. Again, if we are talking about the women and the weaker section of the society, prostitutes should be covered here, and the state can frame special laws for the prostitutes. And if they are framing, it cannot be considered as a violation of the Constitution. So the state is having the power to frame the special laws, so they can frame according to the rule and regulation, and they can provide certain special provision for the upliftment of this unprivileged society. If we are talking about the human right of the prostitution, here I will emphasize only main charter, that is UDHR and CEDAW, because there is time constraint. So UDHR state that everyone has the right to life and liberty and security of the person. No one shall be subjected to torture or inhuman behavior. So if UDHR is giving this power to every citizen, every person of the society, every individual, single individual, so prostitutes should also cover here, and they are having the right that no one can make any act which is coming under the inhuman behavior with them as well. Then we have next convention with us, CEDAW, that is Convention on the Elimination of All Form of Discrimination Against Women. Under this convention, a state can take all the appropriate measures, including legislation, to suppress all form of the traffic in women and exploitation of the prostitution of women. So So this particular convention is talking about the elimination of all type of the discrimination from the society against the women. So a state under this particular convention, a state can frame any special laws for the benefit of the prostitutes, for the upliftment of the prostitutes, and for stopping all type of traffic, human trafficking. Then I will come on the judicial interpretation. So here I will make an emphasis on the two case laws, which is the leading case law whenever we are talking about the prostitute right in the Constitution of India. So here I will emphasize on the first case, the State of Maharashtra versus Madhukar Narayan. In this particular case, Supreme Court held that even the women of the EG virtue have the right to privacy. Means if the women is belonging to any profession which is coming certain type of profession, that is in prostitution, even they have the right to privacy, even they have the right to live a life in a dignified manner. And if they are having that right, no person of the society, no state can violate their right. So if the Supreme Court is giving the direction of such nature, why we are not having any special laws for them? Why the right of the prostitutes has been violated time to time? Next case laws we are having with us, which is Buddhadev Kamaskar versus State of West Bengal. In this case, Supreme Court held that sex workers are also a human being and no one has a right to assault as they have right to live a life in a dignified manner. So Supreme Court is giving the direction. Supreme Court is interpreting the Constitution according to the soul of the Constitution, whatever the Constitution maker want to achieve. But still, we don't have any law which is talking about the right of the prostitution, which is talking about the laws related to the prostitution in our country. Now, I will make an emphasis here only on the laws which prevent the forced prostitution. In our country, forced prostitution has been prohibited. We are having the rule related to that. But if there is any prostitution is going on, any profession of the prostitution is going on, what laws will be applicable? How we will legalize that? What type of provision we will have? We don't have certain type of legislation in our country. So here we are having certain laws which is preventing the forced prostitution. So section 372 and 373 of Indian Penal Code penalize the person who has been involved in this forced prostitution. Means the person who are forcefully running this particular profession, we are having certain rule and regulation for penalizing them. And then conclusion and suggestion. So according to my opinion, there must be certain common societal policy which is talking about the upliftment of the women who has been involved due to any unavoidable circumstances, due to unavoidable situation. Whenever they are coming in this profession, we should have certain policy for them for the upliftment of that particular weaker section of the society. Then second thing, as per my research, we can go for the education of the women who has been involved in this particular profession, as well as education of the children of the prostitution. So they should not be involved in this particular field. Means if they are having the literacy, if they are having the education, if they are properly educated and can get the better job opportunity somewhere, so where their dignity can be maintained, so we have to do something regarding the education of the prostitutes as well as education of the children of the prostitutes. Then next thing, whatever we can do for this particular community of the society, self-employment opportunity. So there may be certain skill development courses can be run under this head, and the women who has been involved in this particular field, so if they are skilled in other field, they can go for the self-employment opportunity state can provide them. Then rehabilitation program and follow-up program should be there. So rehabilitation center must be there where state should develop the skill in the women who has been involved in this particular field. and a rehabilitation program should be there for the children of the prostitutes as well. Then in last, we can say we have to develop, the state have to develop a committee to access the justice. Access the justice means prostitutes are not aware about their rights. Their children are not aware about rights. So there must be a special designed committee who have the rights to access the justice and can protect the basic human right of the prostitutes and the children of the prostitutes. Thank you.
We now request Ms. Ayati Mohanty, lecturer, C.V. Raman Global University, Bhubaneswar, India, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
Hello, everyone. I am Ayuta Mohanty from Department of HSS, C.V. Raman Global University. And the topic I am going to present is Mahabharati, Women from the Mythology. As we all know that India is a patriarchal society and hence has rarely given its women the respect that they deserve. Women have always been neglected in the mythological literature in a patriarchal society. Most of the patriarchal mythological literatures have been written by men, and hence women's issues, roles, thoughts, relationships, and identity have been portrayed to fit into the patriarchal norms. Women have been interpreted in the way the patriarchal society wanted it to be, either passive onlookers or root cause of all problems, or examples of how a woman should not be. But contemporary writers have started a trend of reinterpreting and revisioning the mythological literature and characters to fit them into the modern canvas. This paper focuses on Shruti H. Gupte's Mahabharati that explores the active role of five women from Mahabharata in the narrative, their thoughts, their actions, their consequences, their personality, and their relationships. These five women are totally different from each other, but are joined by a single cause to set a better example for the women of every age. Just like Panchabhuta, these five women gives the readers an insight into the epic from their own perspective. Methodology. So the work is primarily based on textual analysis of selected retelling of Mahabharata. Analysis has been done using the literary concept of feminist revisionist mythology and an attempt to investigate the socio-cultural aspects that might be influenced by the retelling has been done. The first character is Satyavati, the great matriarch of Kuru dynasty. She is a bold, ambitious, and an intelligent lady. She had controlled the affairs of the Kuru court effectively during her time. Her knowledge of importance of power and authority, her intelligence, her tactful use of words and courage made her the driving force of the Kurus. She had the potential to handle the dynasty single-handedly, and her journey from a fisher girl to the great matriarch of Kuru dynasty can be seen as an allegory of womanly accomplishment, symbol of woman power and woman empowerment. Though she came to stop the war, she leaves the battlefield with the attainment of real essence of liberation. Through Parikshit, she gets her hire and legacy to continue for several generations to come, a right that was denied to her by her father for being a girl. Satyavati can be seen as an element of water. Just like water in the Panchabhuta, her life flows on, crossing all obstacles that came in her way. Like water mixes with anything and takes it color, she tackles each person in there based on their nature. A practical approach towards life helped her to find solutions to every problem, just like water finds a crack to continue its flow. When water flows forcefully, the area gets flooded. Similarly, Satyavati's actions have served the same purpose and created turbulent storms and floods in the Kuru dynasty. Just as water flows into sea and becomes a part of it, her journey from a fisher girl to a commanding matriarch of a great dynasty and being an inseparable part implies so. Gandhari, the next character. She brings out the fact that mothers have the power to mold the character of their children, but the male-dominated society never allows a woman to wield her power. Her blindfold represents her rebellion against the deceit the cheat has done against her by Hastinapur. A sense of righteousness, patience, belief in dharma encouraged her to flow with the tides of life. Though she had wished the work to stop, at the end of the fiction, she was the first one who decided to view the work as a means of establishing righteousness. Gandhari can be seen as air, element of air. Air is unseen, unrecognized, and elusive in nature. So is Gandhari. Though she was unrecognized and unacknowledged, she had endless power. Kunti, the mother of the Pandavas, was a strong force who established a strong moral foundation for the five brothers. She was the binding force that kept the brothers together. Draupadi also acknowledges that Kunti was a true warrior in spirit and a strong pillar that provided the real strength to the Pandavas. Kunti can be considered as an element of earth, because of her nurturing nature, skills of adaptation, sustainment, protective nature, patience, strong will, resourcefulness, fertileness, adherence to dharma, and feeling of contentment and satiety. The next character is Draupadi. A strong, fierce, bold, and courageous woman who will remain engraved in the pages of history for several generations to come. Draupadi protested that why it is only women that has to live under bondage. She considered her tied hair as a symbol of bondage. Her strong resolution that this war must happen is not just for herself, for her revenge. It's for the women of every age. Even Satyavati could see the passion, the fighting spirit, and the unbreakable spirit in her eyes. These two dialogues spoken by Draupadi in the fiction focuses on how independent and advanced and modern her thinking was even during that period. Draupadi can be seen as the element of fire. Just like fire has luster and dark side, so has Draupadi. Draupadi was of dark complexion but was lustrous and attractive. Just like fire stands for purity, so does Draupadi. Just like fire, Draupadi had the passion to accomplish any cause she truly believed in. Just like fire, Draupadi also embodies power and strength. But fire also symbolizes destruction. And Draupadi also played an instrumental role in bringing the destruction of the evil and unrighteous people. Rukmini, the last but not the least. An equally strong and courageous lady who supports Draupadi and made the other women realize that it is very important for women to stand united to resist injustice against them. She considered the war will teach a lesson to the society that insolence to a woman brings the downfall of that society. Rukmini makes the woman realize that they had always had their own independent thought and that has changed the course of destiny. Strength, determination, strong will, broad independent thinking, all these characteristics made Rukmini a forebearer of the feminist movements that came centuries later. Rukmini can be seen as the element of space, as she symbolized enormity and independent judgment. Just as the space is just like the soul in the body, Rukmini is the soul of womanhood. To conclude, I would like to say that when the men were divided in the battle, the women stood united with each other and protested against injustice done to them and to establish dharma or righteousness. These five women were strong, bold, and courageous in their own might. Each of them has some characteristics that women of every age, every era should reflect upon and try to follow. The fiction clearly reflects upon the power and strength of these five women and depicts them as the role models for women of every generation. Thank you.
We now request Ms. Sahi Shaika, research scholar, Amity University, Noida, Uttar Pradesh, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Shahi Shaika, and I'm a PhD scholar at Amity University, Noida, in the Department of Communication and Journalism. So today, my presentation is about globalization and its impact on Kashmiri culture. It's a critical analysis of what globalization has done in Kashmir. So first of all, I'd like to introduce about what globalization is before talking about how globalization has had an impact on Kashmiri culture or how it has been changing the way Kashmiri culture is now as compared to how it was earlier. So first of all, what is globalization? So if I define globalization is an increased quantitative and qualitative number of global flows, which improves or deteriorates people's everyday lives. So globalization is not always positive. In many ways, it can be positive, where it can improve the people's lives, but sometimes it can also be deteriorative. So it can sometimes be taken in a very negative way also. There are different types of globalizations. So it can be economical, political, cultural globalizations, but all these globalizations come under a single term, that is globalization. That is an umbrella term. And all these terms like economic globalization, political and cultural globalization, they come under an umbrella term of globalization. And all of them are interconnected and interrelated to each other. So the most common characteristic of globalized culture is that it comes up with the idea that one size fits all. So the result of this cultural homogeneity, like the homogeneity which is across the globe these days, like there is no differentiation between the people who live in West and who live in this part of the world, you can find a lot of homogeneity among them. So this homogenization in the larger section of the world, like people have started believing that living your life according to the characters of the American soap operas is the best way of living their lives. And they have taken over traditional values, and the Coca-Cola culture has been imbibed by everybody across the globe. So we can say that our old cultures are vanishing and Coca-Cola cultures are coming up into our lives. And this is creating an homogeneity across the globe. So if we talk about the style of music or different genres of music, like every country has different genres of music. Even inside the country, we have sub-genres of music. Like different states have different cultural musics. They have indigenous musics. They have folk musics. But all these music genres are becoming obsolete and people are sticking more towards Michael Jackson type of music, hip-hop music, rap music. That is a pop culture kind of music. So the elite kind of music is not being found nowadays, but not being liked by the majority of the people. And it's becoming very difficult for us to cope up with all this because the world scenario is changing a lot. Now, talking about how globalization has affected Kashmir or what kind of effect globalization has on the cultural makeup of Kashmir. Kashmir is becoming global. It's becoming a place where you have a global culture, either indirectly or directly, but it is becoming part of the global culture. Now, how is it becoming part of the global culture? Where from does this global culture come into Kashmir? It's because of media. And if you talk of media, electronic and new media have been playing a very major role for connecting the people from this part of the world to the West. so that they can come up and form a global similar culture. So people in Kashmir can be seen these days, they can be seen adopting a fast food culture, wearing Western dresses, and majority of the young generation, they don't like speaking in their mother tongue. They rather prefer speaking in an English language, and they feel that speaking in English is much more better than communicating in their mother tongue. Again, the choice of music has changed. Kashmir is known for its rich cultural music, rich folk music, and amazing lyrical music of Kashmir. But the generation today and the people today, they are shifting to different Western hip-hop style musics. Their choices are changing. So the objectives of the study are that I wanted to study the impacts of globalization first on the dress code among the Kashmiris, because every place has a different kind of dress codes which differentiates it from the rest of the world. That because dress is a very important part of culture. Similarly, in Kashmir, the dress code among the Kashmiris or among the young generation, how globalization has changed it. The second objective of my study is that to study the impact of globalization on Kashmiri language, since language is the most important way in which a human communicates, about his society. And it's said that language is a mirror of the society. So how globalization has impacted the language. And thirdly, my third objective is that I want to identify the role of media in bringing a level of homogeneity between Kashmir and rest of the cultures. So I just wanted to find out what role media has played and which medium of communication has been responsible for bringing rest of the cultures to Kashmir and bringing that homogeneity over there. So the research methodology I have used is the mixed methodology. I have used both qualitative and quantitative ways to reach to my, to understand my objectives and answer my questions. So the data in the qualitative way has been gathered through academic websites, research papers, journals, and books, and it has been combined with an exhaustive internet research. So if I talk about the quantitative part of my research methodology, I have used purposive sampling technique in which I took a sample and a sample of respondents, and I gave a questionnaire to them, and based on the answer of those questions, I was able to understand and answer my objectives. So this is my sample. Basically, I used 200 respondents from Kashmir University in an equal proportion of male and female. I chose the university students because they are in an age group of 20 to 25 years, and this generation has seen a lot of transition from a very low level of media use to a very high level of media use. And they have seen a time from which globalization has become more of a way of life rather than being a concept. Because Marshall McLuhan came up with globalization, and he defined globalization as globalization is converting a world into a village. So apart from making it a concept and making it a practicality, considering globalization as a practicality, this generation has seen a lot of transitional stage. So that's why I took this generation as my sample age group. So they are the students from Kashmir University, and I, as I already said, I took 100 males and 100 females, so that there is no bias between how globalization has affected males and females. I just wanted to study how it has affected both the genders. And now the theoretical framework. Since there are many theories on culture, there are many theories on communication, there are many theories on effects, how different things have affected individuals lately. But according to this study, I found that the theory of world risk society has found best to my study, because it basically concentrates on the ethical questions. It concentrates on ecological catastrophes. It concentrates on humanitarian crisis, economical imbalance, and many other things that are related to the society when you take globalization into consideration. What happens when globalization becomes a way of living rather than a concept? There are many things that come into play, and that these things create a threat in a society. There are changes happening in a society every now and then. they are unintended changes. There are conflicts happening, conflict of interest happening because of those changes. And the concept of materialization comes into play where the world is converting people into machines. And the human labor is being replaced by machines. And the concept of fast food culture is spreading like a wave across the globe, and everybody is interested, or everybody is a lover of fast food chains across the globe. And it has somehow homogenized everything, because you will find a McDonald's burger somewhere in India, somewhere in Kashmir, and across the globe. It's a name which has gained a homogeneity. Then I like to focus more on my results, like what are the statistical results I got after considering my purpose of sampling. The first question that was given to the respondents is, which medium do you use to know about the West? Because I was concentrating more on the medium of communication, through which medium the respondents get to know the information about how West is changing, what are the different styles in West, what is the way of living, what are different fashion things that are coming in West, because at the end of the day, people believe it has become a quotation that people believe that Western ideology is the more better ideology. It's the most vast ideology, and it's the most accepted ideology. So where do Kashmiri generation or Kashmiri people get this information about the West from? 60% of the respondents believe that internet is the source of information to get the information about West. 20% believe that it's television, and followed by 10% for radio and magazines. Another question was, which is your preferable food choice? Since fast food culture, like I mentioned, McDonaldization is becoming a concept across the world, and people are loving fast food and they are ignoring their local foods. So I have mentioned one of the local foods of Kashmir, one of the street foods of Kashmir, that's masal soot. And on the contrary, I have given them another option with pizza. So 85% of the respondents believe that their preferable choice for food is pizza, and 15% vote for the local street food. Which genre of music do you like the most? Since I said in the beginning of my presentation that the music choices across the globe are changing, and we are more into the pop culture, pop music. So here again, I found it from my respondents that 57% of the respondents believe or they like hip hop music, followed by 23% like ghazals, 15% like Sufi, and 5% like chakar, which is the indigenous, which is the local music of Kashmir. So only 5% of the respondents believe that they like chakar. On the contrary, you can see hip hop is liked by 57% of the respondents. Which dress style do you prefer? Since westernization has come up with the concept of one size fits all, and we have started believing that Western dresses are more comfortable as compared to our ethnic or our cultural dresses. This is happening across the globe, and people are preferring wearing a jeans, wearing a top, wearing a dress, because they believe that that's a very comfortable kind of comfortable kind of an attire. So here the respondents believe, 68% of the respondents believe and think that the Western attire is the dress code that they will prefer over ethnic and cultural, which gets the percentage of 32% only. Which is your preferable language of communication? Since we know that majority of the people believe that when you talk in English, it gives a more impact upon anybody who is hearing your conversation other than talking in a language which is your local language. Say, for example, if you're talking on an international platform, then I can understand that English is a language which is preferred. But if you're locally talking, and again, even talking locally at your place, you prefer English as a language. So you can understand by this kind of percentage that how much English has been dominating us, that we prefer English 65%, and only 5% votes have been given to Kashmiri. That means our indigenous, our mother tongue gets only 5% respondents believe that we should communicate in that language. 65% of the respondents believe that English is the preferred language of communication, followed by Urdu, that's 30% only. So here I come up with the conclusion of my research that with the concepts like globalization, English is becoming an imperative language, and Kashmiris, especially the youth, have started viewing Kashmiri as a burden left by their forefathers, which serves no particular utility. So they believe that Kashmiri is just a language, merely a language which doesn't serve any purpose in their lives. And they should learn English, fluent English, different words in English. They should increase their English vocabulary rather than learning Kashmiri. So by this, I can understand that globalization has had a very negative impact on the language of Kashmir. The statistical analysis of the research activity revealed that globalization has great impact on music choices, cultural practices, and lifestyles. Since in my last slides, I have shown that the music choices of Kashmiri people are 58% of the people, they believe that hip hop is their choice, and only merely a small percent of the people voted for their indigenous music, the chakar. So you can understand how globalization has impacted music. Cultural practices, we have started changing the way of celebrating our marriages, celebrating our birthdays, our different ceremonies, engagement parties, all are getting a Western touch in it. So that way you can understand how Westernization is impacting even the smallest way of celebration in our lives. And the lifestyle. Since I said the dress code mentioned earlier, the dress code preferred by most of the respondents was the Western as compared to the ethnic or the cultural dress code. Now the media, because I was also working on which medium is the most used medium or through which medium the respondents get to know about the Western influences or the Westernization. So new media has come up as the medium which mostly people get the, through which people get about the Western ideology, followed by the electronic media. So people get to know about Western things like what is in West, which celebrity is wearing what on Cannes festival, or which movie is coming up, or what are the kinds of soap operas playing on the television on the West. You all get to know these things through new media as per the respondents, followed by electronic media, that's television and magazines and radio after that. So I like to conclude my presentation. Thank you all for lending me a patient ear. Thank you so much.
We now request Ms. Lopreet, research scholar, Lovely Professional University, Punjab, to kindly present her paper. Madam.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lopreet. I am a PhD research scholar at Lovely Professional University. Today, I am going to present my presentation on the topic Disabled Women and Inclusive Development, a Twin Track Approach. Twin track approach is a combination of mainstreaming and a targeting at the same time. Introductory inclusion. Inclusion is a term which is used for the disabled people by focusing upon the idea that so they can enjoy a free accommodation and living in the same environment or safe surrounding as the other normal persons are living. According to the United Nations, disabled person in a mainstreaming requires the equal opportunities and equal participation by intergovernmental, governmental, private sector, or the other stakeholders. Or it also focusing upon the no gap policy, which means everyone has a responsibility for providing equal opportunity. All persons are under the responsibility or obligation for working for the equality. Equality means the equality for all, including the disabled persons. Twin track approach. It is a twin track approach which focuses upon addressing the inequalities between the disabled and non-disabled persons. Same initiatives for empowering the disabled women, especially to disabled women. Equal rights and opportunities for the persons who are suffering from the disability. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Person with Disability. Article 4 of this convention outlines the general obligation, which means providing the equal laws and policies to the disabled people as the other persons are enjoying. Article 32 focuses upon the inclusive development, which means development and growth for all, including disabled people and the special rights and qualities for the disabled people. Women and girls with disabilities, as we all know, we are living in a patriarchal society. Women is faced many discrimination or also suppressed and oppressed in our patriarchal society from the ancient times. No doubt, according to the changing time and need, their position has also got changed. But according to the time and need, according to the changing laws, there are no separate laws or policies which provide protection separately to the disabled women. Disabled women face many discrimination at the gender-based violence, sexual abuse, and at many spheres they are exploited. According to the United Nations Development Report and their study, the literacy rate of disabled women is low as compared to the disabled men. They are facing many violence, physical abuse at many spheres of their life. Marriage, sexuality and reproduction, they are also facing while getting married or while bearing a child or giving or while getting pregnant, they are facing many problems. Mostly women is also known as a nurturer, loving, caring, homemaker, but these terms are not comfortable for the disabled women because of their disability they are treated separately. They are not provided with the same rights and benefits as the other normal women are getting. According to the study of the Hanford, women with a disability mostly live in abusive or exploitative relations and needs a better life, which is not provided till yet. No doubt many laws or policies are there, but their position has not changed in a present scenario. They are mostly discriminated on the grounds of on the grounds of their disability. They are not easily got married or easily pregnant because of their disability. People think that they can bear a child or they cannot take care of their child as a normal lady can do. Education wise, they are also facing the discrimination. Discrimination or difficulties while getting the education. This chart shows the comparison rate between the disabled men and disabled women who are getting the education from colleges. For disabled women, it is 16%. For disabled men, this chart shows 32%. For non-disabled women, it's about 28%. It means. Half of the disabled women got the education as compared to disabled men or a non-disabled woman. Employment sector, they are also facing the same position as in education level. Blue line graph shows for the disabled men and the disabled woman is a red graph shows the for disabled women. For getting the job or in a labor market or getting earning, they are facing the discrimination. They are denied their earnings or wages because of their disability. In health sector, they are also facing the problems. They need a separate or specific provisions and schemes which empower the disabled women. But these are not provided, and especially not provisions separately for the rural areas and the women who are living in the rural areas. Article 28 of the CRPD, adequate standard of living and social protection guarantees the adequate standard of living and social protection, but these are not specially provided to the disabled women. They are facing discrimination while getting food security, pension, and facing the unemployment. This twin track approach focusing upon the mainstreaming and ensuring empowering the disabled women and providing the equal benefits and equal opportunities to disabled. Twin track approach focusing upon the mainstreaming means ensuring the person with disability assess their basic needs in all intervention and projects, targeting their specific needs by providing equal opportunities and benefits to them. By summing up, we conclude that no doubt there are policies and laws are there, but they are not specifically for the disabled persons, and if they are for the disabled woman, there is not specifically for the disabled woman. For empowering the disabled woman, there is a need for special rights and policies so that we can empower the disabled woman and their position got changed. They can enjoy their life as other normal women are living. So there is a need for providing a specific provisions with CRPD, and also a need for the changes and a new laws in a domestic legislation. Thank you.
We now request Ms. Neelanjana Saha, research scholar, Amity University, Noida, Uttar Pradesh, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
Hello, everyone. Greetings of the day. I am Neelanjana Saha, and I'm a research scholar from Amity University, Noida. I'll be presenting you about the nuclear engineering education, its significance in the developing countries post-World War II. The importance of it is actually felt in today's era because of arms race that we all know. And there has been an exact shift from a peaceful way of energy to a more military use of energy. So the peaceful use of energy has been somehow been subjugated in the terms of, like, you know, enhancing national security purpose, or probably for, like, you know, getting the power and prestige status in the world. So I'll read out the abstract of the paper. I'll read out that to you first so that, you know, you become familiar to what is actually the crux of the paper. So here we go with the abstract. It says that nuclear engineering has become an integral part in higher educational system and learning process today. After the end of the World War II, it has emerged and developed into a new discipline. Since then, nuclear engineering was not limited to the motive of acquiring atom bomb, but research continued for the use of nuclear energy and the application of the emitted radioactive elements in various sectors and industries like medicine, agriculture, electricity production, and water transport, and other civilian purposes, as we all know. Now, these indicated that nuclear engineering and nuclear energy need not be confined to military field, our national security as such, but can prove to be fruitful or peaceful on civilian grounds as well. Many developing countries took the advantage of the then 1953 Atoms for Peace program, which was introduced by the then US President Eisenhower at the United Nations General Assembly. Not only possessing of nuclear reactors and being capable of building nuclear weapons, but also the cheap production and supply of electricity attracted the countries worldwide. Students and scholars were sent overseas for training, and simultaneously nuclear engineering grew up as an education. Nevertheless, the management of radioactive waste produced by these nuclear energy usage was not focused upon by many of the developing countries, which is detrimental to living beings for thousands of years. This stipulates the urgency of redesigning and implementing nuclear engineering education in such a way that the pros and cons of nuclear energy is magnified and worked upon accordingly. So I have shared, like, obviously the entire paper is not at all easy to put up, like, in a 10-minute presentation. So I've taken out the main things that I've actually focused on my paper. And this is how the crux of the paper goes as. Now, nuclear engineering, now it is obviously important for us to know actually what nuclear engineering stands for and why, as an education, nuclear engineering is very much important to us in today's world, and how it actually has evolved as a discipline ever since, you know, World War II, and what are the advantages that we actually have and what are the drawbacks that we actually have. I've discussed all these things on my paper, and here I present you the crux of the paper. Now, nuclear engineering is the field of engineering that deals with the science and application of nuclear and radiation process. This process includes the release and control and utilization of nuclear energy and the production and use of radiation and radioactive materials for application in research industry, medicine, and national security. Nuclear engineering was born in the 20th century with the announcement in 1939 of the discovery of nuclear fission by the German chemist Otto Hahn and Fritz Strassmann. It was almost immediately realized that a weapon of enormous explosive energy might be possible by employing fission, and during the World War II, the race to be the first to build the weapon led to the creation of the Manhattan Project in the US. So the seminal work of the Manhattan Project, led by the Italian physicist Enrico Fermi, was the building of the first nuclear reactor in 1942 at the University of Chicago. Now, all this research obviously proceeded, and we all know that, you know, by the end, almost by the end of the 1945, it was on 6th August that the bomb, or the atom bomb, was actually, you know, dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the twin cities of Japan, which marked the end of the World War II, but also alerted the world the presence of atom bomb, which was already there with the US then. And now, after the World War ended, it triggered the countries in building and possessing the nuclear bomb, which in turn would not only strengthen the defense system, but also enable in maintaining status quo with the nuclear weapon states, thereby portraying its power and might. This issue became so much intense that possessing nuclear weapons became a matter of pride and prestige for the nations. Hence, nuclear engineering education started to gear up, skill, and train student scholars on nuclear energy and tell about the several usages. Research started, and there was more focus was given on defense system in the initial stages, but later, like, you know, its civilian purposes were also held. However, it has got ignored in today's world. Now, even after initiating and commencing the Atoms for Peace program, which was introduced on 8th December by the then US President Eisenhower, as I've already discussed in the, you know, abstract, and it was done on the 417th plenary meeting at the UNGA, the focus did not get even shift to the peaceful uses of nuclear energy during that time. Rather, many developing countries took the advantage of this program and started using nuclear energy for military purposes in the name of civilian purpose. Now, many developing countries were of the favor of using it for civilian purposes as well, and they started using it for the civilian purposes. But later on, the turmoils inflicted so much with the neighboring countries, and also the, to match up with the status quo, and the coming in of the sanctions from the already developed world actually, you know, enabled them or actually provoked them in creating atom bomb. And when the, you know, this developed countries provided them with reactors, and, you know, those reactors, when they became inefficient, they started having, or, you know, having their own nuclear program. And also, again, at the same time, during that period, it is important for us to note that there was already existing Cold War, which was going on. And the fear of falling into the prey of their existing powers during that time, the USA and the USSR, it actually made the developing countries, or actually pushed the developing countries, to develop nuclear weapons for the national security purposes, and hence the civilian program was not much cared upon. Now, all these events further pushed nuclear energy and nuclear engineering to emerge as a separate discipline more vibrantly and fall into the streamline of the education system. On the contrary, the usage and the other usage of nuclear energy were taken and minor notice were actually given, especially in the use of nuclear energy. But the electricity that was produced because of this nuclear fission and with the help of nuclear energy, which was of very low cost but actually required higher investment, was actually focused on by many of the developing countries. However, the nuclear waste produced is not being managed and is actually being out of order and control in the developing countries. Nuclear engineering in these countries seeing only the usage of nuclear energy but not the managing of the nuclear waste. And this caused the urgent need of redesigning nuclear energy and nuclear engineering education in these countries, as long exposure to nuclear waste is dangerous to human life. Now, nuclear waste mainly composed of radioactive waste, and that is why it is actually detrimental to human health. So, the management of radioactive waste becomes very important. Now, for radioactive waste, this means isolating or diluting it in such a way that the rate of concentration of any radionuclides returned to the biosphere becomes harmless. To achieve this, particularly all radioactive waste is contained and managed with some clearly needing and deep and permanent burial. However, this is actually done in the developed countries. There is a lack of knowledge which is actually going on in the developing countries because the focus has been repeatedly being shifted from the civilian purposes to the military purposes, and the management of radioactive waste or nuclear waste as such is being ignored to a height. Now, from nuclear power generation, unlike all other forms of thermal electricity generation, all waste is regulated. None is allowed to cause pollution. Nuclear power is characterized by very large amount of energy produced from a very small amount of fuel, and the amount of waste produced during this process is also relatively small. However, much of the waste produced is radioactive, and therefore it is actually needed to be carefully managed because it is actually hazardous and it is injurious to human life. Now, all parts of the nuclear fuel cycle produce some radioactive waste, and the cost of managing and disposing of this is the part of electricity cost. All toxic waste needs to be dealt with safety measures, and not just radioactive waste. And in other countries with nuclear power, radioactive waste comprises a very small portion of all industrial hazardous waste generated. But this is actually getting accumulated in the developing countries, because of which the driving concern of actually making them understand the importance of managing radioactive waste and, you know, falling or actually implying radioactive waste management as a part of nuclear engineering education has become very important. So radioactive waste is not unique to the nuclear fuel cycle. Radioactive materials are used extensively in medicine, agriculture, research, manufacturing, non-destructive testing, and minerals exploration as well. Unlike other hazardous industrial materials, however, the level of hazard of radioactive is diminishes with time. But all this, the usefulness of the radioactive materials and the usefulness of the, you know, nuclear waste in various activities and in various aspects has to be, you know, manifested to these developing countries so that it is not exposed to human health as such. So at the end of everything, it becomes very important to define and uphold the importance of nuclear engineering education in the developing countries, especially when the public perception of nuclear science and engineering and the nuclear industry is today primarily shaped by radical greens, nuclear opponents, the media, and socio-political opportunists. only countries with a well-diversified tertiary education system embracing all aspects of nuclear science and engineering can counter efficiently the pseudoscience and sociopolitical manipulations which has severely restricted nuclear energy development over the past three decades. So this is where I end with my presentation, and any of the questions will be absolutely, you know, appreciated, and I'll be glad enough to answer it. Thank you.
We now request Ms. Pavani Randoi, student, JSS Law College, Mysuru, Karnataka, to kindly present her paper. Madam, please.
Greetings to the panel present. My name is Pavani Randoi. I am finally a student from JSS Law College. I'll be presenting a paper that I've done with Dr. N. Vanishree. The paper is Women Leading Light of the Social Mandate. To start with, what the paper is about. This paper focuses on the women leadership skills during the time of COVID-19 and now how they have been more effective in dealing with the crisis. And it has also focuses on various kind of different leadership styles and how empathy plays an important role in being one of the most important qualities for leadership. Further, the paper also discusses how various women leaders have been successful to deal with the crisis in a much more efficient way than their colleagues present in the world, with empathy being a key factor in the leadership. Moving further, what are the different kinds of leadership? So leadership styles can be defined as a person's way of governing, directing, and motivating followers. Over the last 50 years, we have seen how researchers have proposed a number of different leadership styles, and psychologists also have tried to curate, like, what are the typical leadership styles, or one of the way a leader works. So as we all know, some of the main traditional leadership styles being authoritarian leaders, democratic leaders, laissez-faire leadership. The modern technique here is the transactional leadership and the transformational leadership. Now, transformational leadership has characters from both democratic style as well as authoritarian style. They are democratic, they ask for people's opinion, they ask their workers what they think of, and they see the, and then they analyze it, and then they take their own call. So now what happens, like, in transformational leadership, it's to transform the world. And we are living in 21st century, and it is important we have new ways to govern people, new ways where the youth accepts a leader. So transformational leadership has played a vital role in that sphere. The next slide focuses on COVID-19 pandemic leadership that says how the pandemic has shown women's work is essential work. As the pandemic has also shined on how intersecting the streams of marginalization across the race, class, ethnicity, combined to keep these segments of the population poor or sicker or more powerless. There are many countries who have multi-party democracies with high levels of public trust in their governments and have contained the pandemic through early and scientific interventions. They have implemented widespread testing, easy access to quality medical treatments, aggressive contract tracing, and tough restrictions on social gatherings. Some of the countries that are led by women, like Taiwan, Germany, New Zealand, Nordic countries, and Finland, they have shown better results. In Taiwan, the Prime Minister of Taiwan made sure that she, when the first case was being reported, she made sure to cut ties from China, the travel from China, and she did aggressive contact tracing. In Germany, their chancellor, she made sure the economy, the lockdown was there, Germany is considered to be the only European country who has been able to, the big European country who has been able to contain the virus. Because if we see on the other hand, UK did miserably, and the prime minister also got the virus. And also on the other hand, we have New Zealand, who had almost 100 days of no single coronavirus case in the land. And in Nordic countries like Finland, with Finland having a population of almost about 2 to 3 million of people, which is more than more for them for the size of the country, she being the youngest leader on the world leadership list, has been able to control. Now, it is important to understand how they have been able to do it. How they, instead of Trump, who was being a bit arrogant about the virus from the starters, how they have ensured this pandemic doesn't spread. That is because empathy. Empathy is the key here. Now, empathy means the action of understanding, being aware of, being sensitive to, and vicariously experiencing the feelings, thoughts, and experience of another, either past or present, without having the feelings, thoughts, and experience fully communicated in objective and explicit manner. Now, women have more of empathy quotient than men. That is a natural fact that exists. So empathy is described by different people, and its basic term is all about putting yourself in another person's shoes. And women are known to do that from a very long time. So it is important in understanding and identifying other people's feelings and then responding to it accordingly. Empathy, the relationship between the leaders and followers is also important. If there is, it's a great success. Then we have to see the role of empathy. Empathy plays an important role because it enables to connect you with your subordinates or with your followers, or with more personal space. And what are the repercussions of lack of empathy? US is one of the repercussions of lack of empathy. The president was not empathetic enough towards the virus, and he did make mistakes, and that's why that's the country with the highest number of cases right now. So we have to be empathetic because we have to give the space for others to also grow. If we are trying to be a good leader, we have to give space to others as well. So that's what empathy is. In order to conclude, 3.5 decades ago, there was an overall lack of consciousness, sensitivity, and understanding of how well our old structures of patriarchy functioned within female, within families, within homes, villages, society. Patriarchy is something that is so deep rooted that one generation cannot just take it out. It's constant work of all the generation who has to work against that norm. Women indeed were ignored. Women are still being ignored. We believe that a sector of citizen activists and researchers have experience, and they are bringing out their experience and expression, and also through deep, when we take examples of great women leaders, we get to know their personal experiences as well. Also, women leadership recognizes that all meaningful and enduring change begins with internal work we do to transform our outer behavior, and leadership skill and capacity to continue and strengthen these practices and relations that provide authenticity and rigorous feedback and support. That's why the women leaders right now are proving to be more empathic, though there can't be a concrete saying that women were more effective, because we still have a long way to go. But whatever the surveys have been done, whatever the studies have been conducted, they all say that. Also, I'm not saying that there are countries like South Korea and Singapore who have male leaders and who have done very well to fight this pandemic, but as compared to other world leaders like Russian President Vladimir Putin or the British Prime Minister, women have proved to be better. So with that, I'll conclude and thank you for listening to me and thank you for this opportunity.